Code Talker by Joseph Bruchak, published by the Penguin Group. Please excuse the mispronunciation of any Navajo words. Chapter 5, High School. At first, my time in the boarding school did not go quickly. In fact, the days were so long that it sometimes seemed as if each one was a year. Despite the boredom and the loneliness, I kept on working hard. Trying to do well became my way of surviving, just as some of the other students got by simply by going somewhere else inside themselves, showing a blank and stupid face to our Biligana teachers whenever they were asked to do anything. Then those teachers would shake their heads and go on to someone else. Most of those teachers expected very little of us, and that was just what some of us gave back in return. But that was not my way. I have always loved to learn, even though the learning they offered us was much less than that given to Biligana children. Some of my other classmates survived boarding school by throwing themselves into the sports that we played. The older boys had basketball and baseball and football teams. After we younger boys got to know those sports, which none of us had ever seen before being sent off to school, we too became great fans. Some of us wanted nothing more than to become one of those heroic Indian athletes, like Jim Thorpe, who wore a sports uniform and did great things on the playing field. Whenever we played a game against other Indian schools, I was always among those cheering loudly for our side. But little I was when I came to school, and little I stayed. I grew some, but reluctantly. I'd never be more than a few inches above 5 feet. I was too small to play sports. I couldn't hope to become one of those athletes who recklessly threw their bodies against each other with as much energy as our warriors in the old days had hurled themselves at our enemies. Even though my body would not grow tall, somehow I knew that there was no limit to the growth of my mind. I read and studied and wrote, and my teachers noticed. I still didn't speak up much in class. That would have been calling attention to myself, or embarrassing to the other students who did not do so well in their studies. Instead, I just did well on my written work, passing tests with high grades and handing in assignments done in perfect English. "Nettie, you are almost as bright as a little white child," the teachers would say, meaning to compliment me. "You should speak up more in class." Some of them would even pat me on my head as if I were a little pet monkey that had just done well at obeying a command. "Thank you, teacher," I would answer in a voice just loud enough to be heard. Someday, I said to myself, I will become a teacher, one who does not just teach, but also shows respect to all his Indian students and expects the best of everyone. I worked hard with that goal in mind, because I took such interest in my studies and in that good goal of becoming a teacher, time no longer crawled by like a snail trying to get to the top of a big stone. The hours and days, the weeks and months, and even the years grew legs and began to run like an antelope. Almost before I knew it, the day came when I graduated from the mission school. For many Navajo students, this was the end of formal education, but I had done so well that I was accepted into the high school program. It made me so happy. There were two good things about the high school program. The first and best was that instead of being a journey of many days, Navajo High School was only 20 miles away from my home. I would still be living in a school dormitory, but now I would be close enough to visit my parents often and the younger brothers and sister who had been born during my years at boarding school. At the old school, I could only go home summers. Now I would be with my family every weekend and every holiday. I have said that there were two good things about the high school program. The second was that the teaching was better. Since we had gained that much education, the high school teachers assumed that we were educable. They did not often do such things as use our entire school day cleaning classrooms and washing the windows of the building. More information was offered to us, along with a real library. I read every book I could get my hands on, and welcomed the challenge of better classes.
I excelled in English and in social studies. One social studies paper that I wrote during my first year in high school, I remember particularly well. I did not realize it at the time, but it dealt with people and a place that would change my life forever. Those people lived on a group of faraway islands that they called Nippon, but we Americans knew it as Japan. I had read about how those people were having hard times, so I wrote my paper about their suffering. I discussed how difficult it was for them because there were so many of them on their small group of islands. In a space not much larger than our own Navajo homelands, there were 80 million Japanese people. They did not have enough wood or coal to heat their homes. Terrible earthquakes had recently shaken their land. Many Japanese had been killed or injured, and their homes had been destroyed. They had no food and shelter and were in need of help. My social studies teacher was a man named Mr. Strait. He was tall and thin with a sharp face as pale as the crescent moon. He wore very small eyeglasses that were always slipping down on his nose. Those glasses fascinated us students. We all expected that one day they would slip right off and fall to the floor. That day when Mr. Strait nodded his head, after I finished reading my paper, those glasses slid down to the very tip. "Well done, Nettie," he said to me, quickly pushing his glasses back up on his nose, and then tapping me on my shoulder with his long, bony index finger. "I doubt that your average white student could have said it much better." Soon after that, we students at Navajo High School had our own food drive for the poor, hungry Japanese. Even though we came from families much poorer than those average white students, we still were able to collect two big crates of canned goods that became part of the many tons of food relief shipped by America to the islands of Japan. Yo-wee-oh, hey, yo-wee-oh, hey, yo-wee-oh, hey, yo-wee-oh, hey, yo-wee-oh.